Hello friends, I welcome you to my lecture on applications of calculus of variations, where we will first consider the Hamilton's principle, which is also called the variational principle of least action. This principle is one of the most fundamental and important principle of mechanics and mathematical physics. It was given by an Irish mathematician named William Rowan Hamilton during the period 1805 to 1865. By using this principle, the governing equations of many physical phenomena can be deduced. Let us begin by considering the case of a single particle of mass m which is moving in a force field, and let us consider that the position vector of the particle with respect to a fixed origin be r. So let us say this is the position vector of the particle, this is the path of the particle, this is the position of the particle at any point at any time t, and r be the position vector of the particle with respect to a fixed origin. This is your x, y and z axis. So by Newton's law of motion, the path of the particle is then governed by the vector equation m d square r by dt square equal to f, where f is the force acting on the particle. So now let us consider any other path r bar plus delta r bar. Let us consider any other path r bar plus delta r bar. Let us consider any other path r bar plus delta r bar. We assume that the true and the buried paths. So this one is the true path, this true path, and this is buried path. So let us consider any other path r bar plus delta r bar. We assume that the true and the buried path coincide at two distinct instants t1 and t2. So let us say this path and this path, they coincide at some instant t1 and t2. This is t2 instant and this is t1 instant. So the actual path and the varied path, let us assume that they coincide at two distinct instants t equal to t1 and t equal to t2, which will mean that delta r is equal to 0 at t equal to t1 and delta r is equal to 0 at t equal to t2. At any intermediate time, we have to consider the true path and the buried path r bar plus delta r bar. Now from the equation 1, m into d square r by dt square equal to f, we can write this m times d square r by dt square dot dr is equal to f dot dr, and let us integrate with respect to t, with respect to dt. So we have let us integrate with respect to dt. So we shall have this is equal to 0. So we take the dot product on both sides with the dr vector and delta r vector, and then integrate with respect to t, integrate with respect to t from t1 to t2. So what we get is this equation: integral t1 to t2 m d square r by dt square dot delta r minus f dot delta r into dt equal to 0. Now the condition here is that let us apply the condition that delta r at t equal to t1 and at t equal to t2 is 0. Let us evaluate the first term. So integral t1 to t2 m times, let us put m outside, d square r by dt square dot delta r. Let us integrate this with respect to t by parts. So we have dr by dt integral of this d square r by dt square is dr by dt into a dot delta r at t equal to t1 and t equal to t2 minus integral t1 to t2 dr by dt dot delta r into dt. Now delta r is equal to 0 at t equal to t2 and delta r is equal to 0 at t equal to t1. So this will give you minus integral t1 to t2 dr by dt dot delta r dt. So let us put this value in this equation. So then we shall have integral t1 to t2 minus dr by dt dot delta r, this is m times minus f dot delta r dt equal to 0, or we can say integral t1 to t2 m times dr by dt delta r plus f dot delta r equal to 0. And this can be then written as so m f is equal to m d square r by dt square. So what we can say, this is equal to when we integrated by parts we get this. So d square r by dt square, okay sorry, this is like this, not like this. So we get this so this is equal to so m times this, I have not written m here. So this is minus m times, and then I can write it as minus m times t1 to t2, this is delta dr by dt whole square we can write like this, or we can write it as minus t1 to t2 delta 1 by 2 dr by dt m dr by dt whole square like this. So this is equal to this, and or I can write it as minus delta times where T is the kinetic energy, where T is equal to 1 by 2 m dr by dt whole square. So T is the kinetic energy. So I can write the first expression can be written like this, minus delta T1 to T2 T dt, and let us substitute this value in this equation here. Then what do we get? We get the following. So substituting the value of the first term, this is the first term, the value of the first term is minus delta integral t1 to t2 t dt, where t is the kinetic energy in equation 2 means here we put the value of this first term. So then what we get is this integral t1 to t2 delta t plus f dot delta r dt equal to 0. This is called the Hamilton's principle for motion of a single particle. Now if the force is conservative, we know that the force is conservative provided can be written as the gradient of a scalar function. So, if the force is conservative, we can write it in a more concise form. That is, we can, let us say F is equal to xi plus yj plus zk. X, y, z are the components of the force in x, y, z directions. Then we know that a force field is conservative if f dot dr is dr is dxi plus dyj plus dzk. So, f dot dr will be x dx plus y dy plus z dz. This is equal to differential of a single valued function phi. Now, if f is f dot dr is equal to d phi, f dot dr is equal to d phi. So, d phi is equal to delta phi over delta x dx plus delta phi over delta y dy, delta phi over delta z dz. F dot dr is x dx plus y dy plus z dz. So, this is equal to delta phi over delta x dx plus delta phi over delta y dy, delta phi over delta z dz, which means that x is equal to delta phi over delta x, y is equal to delta phi over delta y, and z equal to delta phi over delta z. And so, the field force, which is xi plus yj plus zk, this is equal to I delta phi over delta x plus j delta phi over delta y plus k delta phi over delta z, which is nothing but gradient of phi, grad phi. So, we know that the force field f is conservative if f dot dr is the differential d phi of a single valued function phi, and then f is equal to grad phi. So, the function phi is called the force potential, and its negative, let us say the negative of phi is V. So, V is called the potential energy, and thus F dot delta R, which is equal to delta phi, is equal to minus delta V. And then the Hamilton's principle takes the form. So, Hamilton's principle, which was this, integral T1 to T2 delta T plus F dot dr dt equal to 0, it takes the form delta T1 to T2 T minus V dt equal to 0, which states that the motion is such that the integral of the difference between the kinetic, T is kinetic energy and V is potential energy. So, the integral of the difference between kinetic and potential energies is stationary, because delta of this integral is 0. So, it is stationary for the actual path, and the difference T minus B is called the Lagrangian function. If the time interval is sufficiently short, then it can be proved that the Hamilton's integral, which is integral T1 to T2 T minus B dV, is necessarily a minimum. In this form, the Hamilton's principle is called the principle of least action. Now, this study can be extended to a system of n particles. In the case of discrete system, we will take summation. In the case of continuous system, we will take integration. So, for example, if the position vector of the ith particle of mass mi be ri vector, and if mi is the subjected to the force fi bar, then we shall have the total kinetic energy will be T equal to sigma k equal to 1 to n 1 by 2 mk dr k by dt whole square, while the total work done by the forces will be sigma k equal to 1 to n f k dot delta r k. So, in fact, the Hamilton's principle applies equally well to a general dynamical system which consists of a system of particles and rigid bodies. So, this is one example of the calculus of variations. In our next lecture, we shall take up some more examples on calculus of variations. Thank you very much for your attention.